Greetings, mortals. Welcome to another session of the Infernal Court in Musical Hell. I'm Diva, your judge, jury, and executioner who would smell as sweet by any other name. You know, if you're going to adapt something like Shakespeare, you'd better make sure your adaptation can stand up on its own. Done right, an adaptation can not only be a new perspective on a classic work, but can become a classic in its own right. Done poorly, and, well, you get our next offender, Romeo and Juliet, sealed with a kiss. Written, animated, and directed by Phil Nibbelink, who is either a former Disney employee or a Harry Potter character, I'm not sure which, Romeo and Juliet, sealed with a kiss, because they're seals, haha, I get it, is one man's tribute to a simple idea. Hey, let's do Romeo and Juliet for kids with animals from SeaWorld. Really, that's about the extent of the inspiration here. What's next? King Lear with Galapagos turtles? The Taming of the Shrew with naked mole rats? Hamlet with African... Okay, that one turned out fine. As you might imagine, the budget for this is not extraordinary. That's not necessarily a liability. A lot of good things have come from people working on little more than a shoestring, heart, and talent, including a couple excellent musicals. This, unfortunately, will not be one of those things.
Oh, this is really gonna hurt.
Tell me about it. Let's examine the case of Romeo and Juliet, sealed with a kiss. We begin by establishing the giant bonsai tree, which basically substitutes for the famous balcony. And I mean really establishing it. There's about a minute of this tree getting the hell established out of it before the prologue narration comes in.
In a world not very different from our own, there lived two families, alike in dignity, differing only in color.
Whoops, mind the message, Anvil. So you all know this part. There's Montagues and there's Capulets, and they don't like each other much for unknown reasons, and there will be star-crossed lovers eventually, but first there's... Jazz? I'm not sure how you look at Romeo and Juliet with seals and think big band music, but there you go. The latest episode in the Montague-Capulet feud kicks off when Benvolio, in this version a fat comic sidekick because all kids' movies need a fat comic sidekick, runs into one of the unnamed Capulet seals.
A Capulet!
Montague!
Do you bite your flipper at me, sir? Benvolio runs to the protection of his good buddy Mercutio. Unfortunately for us, as Mercutio is sin number one on this movie's list of offenses. As in the original play, Mercutio is a brash jester given to making jokes even in the most inappropriate of circumstances. Unlike the original play, this Mercutio is not funny. At all.
Why wouldn't the clam share his toys? Because he was selfish!
For most of the movie, Mercutio either pulls random quotes from other Shakespeare plays,
"To be or not to be, that is the question, capiche?
All the world's a stage! Bubble, bubble, toil and trouble!"
Or makes stupid Capulet jokes.
What do you have when a Capulet is buried up to his neck in sand? Not enough sand!
The fact that they've given the feud this whole racial spin just makes this bit really uncomfortable.
You can talk your brain now, motherfucker! Roll his ass off, he's a nigger! He's a nigger! He's a nigger!
All of this is punctuated by Mercutio's infectious laugh, in the sense that it will make you ill to hear it.
That's so funny!
This guy never shuts up. And the worst part is, since this is a kid's movie, we won't even get the satisfaction of watching him get killed. So the Montagues chase the Capulets chase the Montagues, and they all end up burping in each other's faces and having goofy sound effects fights. Eventually, the fight is disrupted by the arrival of Prince. No, not that Prince. Not that one either. All right, now you're doing it on purpose. This Prince, We'll talk more about his sins later, but all you need to know right now is that he's the bad guy and a composite of Prince Escalus, Count Paris, Tybalt, and Barney the Dinosaur's alcoholic uncle. Anyway, he tells the warring clans to knock it off, or else.
Banishment to Shark Island.
Huh, I wonder why they call it that. Oh, thanks. I never would have figured it out on my own. With the ceasefire called, Mercutio gets it into his head to crash the Capulet's party and score some babes. If his pickup lines are any indication, I'm guessing this is because he's already struck out with all the Montague ladies.
What's your sign? Wait, don't tell me. Aquarius!
But before they do, they must first cheer up young Romeo, who's moping because... well, basically because he's a whiny brat. That much hasn't changed.
There was a boy a very strange enchanted boy.
According to his song, Romeo is in a funk because he wants to find love.
Come on, guys. I'm a nobody. Nobody will love me. So lonely, and I need a someone to love, to call my own, someone who wants to share my home.
Even though he can't find a tune, much less anything else. Sin number two. Most of the songs are terribly unmelodic. I don't mean that in the Sondheim modern composition sense. I mean that in the heavily sedated, depressive singing karaoke sense. Check out Mercutio's Serenade of the Young Lovers.
Love is in the air. Love is everywhere. When a sea lion meets a sea lioness, they fall in love.
Miss the earth so much. I miss my wife.
Not that Romeo and Juliet come up with anything better. Sounds like something improvised by a pothead, which may explain why whenever Romeo and Juliet gaze at each other with adoration, they end up looking stoned. Romeo's non-song has put him in the mood for party crashing, so off the dashing youths head to the Capulet shindig. In order to do that, however, they must first find a way to pass for Capulets.
And voila! I am a Capulet.
Kids, try this sometime. Put on blackface makeup and go to a party in South Chicago. See where that gets you. The Montague Seals get to the bash in time to see Prince putting the moves on fair Juliet. Wait a minute, is this the same character from before?
If ever you disturb this beach again, your very lives will pay the price.
I guess so. Well, there's sin number three for you. The villain's characterization is inconsistent. Villains in animated features tend to fall into two categories: sinister villains and comical villains. Typically, the sinister villain will be the main antagonist, and the comical one will be their hanger-on or henchman. Nibelink tries to make Prince both sinister and comical, and ends up doing neither very well. The character pinballs between being a threat and a buffoon so much, it's surprising he doesn't end up in a neck brace.
Let's dance.
Where's Romeo?
Now, Juliet, you will love me. Can I call you Dad?
his villain song ends up being on the goofy side of things, and it pretty much destroys what little credibility he has as a threatening character. How can we take a villain seriously after seeing him like this? It's like finding out the Joker has a collection of Precious Moments figurines. Prince takes a liking to Juliet, even though she's smaller than his nose. By the way, that's sin number 4. Why do Romeo and Juliet look like little kids in this? I mean, I know the whole point of the play is that they're young and stupid, but these incarnations don't look old enough to cross the street on their own, let alone star in a romantic tragedy.
Juliet, I'm not married yet.
Neither am I, but I'd like to wait until I graduate kindergarten. But Prince must have a thing for child brides, because he decides right then and there he's going to marry Juliet, and talks to her dad to seal the deal. While he's thus distracted, the lovers' fateful meeting occurs.
Hi. Hi.
Not exactly if I profane with my unworthiest hand, is it? Prince sees Romeo putting the moves on his newly betrothed, and they do a Looney Tunes chase around the ship. Romeo escapes, but not before his cover gets blown, shocking his beloved. So she goes to mope and sigh under the tree of great significance.
Romeo, Romeo, where are you, my Romeo?
Oh, come on, you couldn't get that line right? And I'm sorry, I know it's a little thing, but hey, what's the point of doing this job if you can't be nitpicky once in a while? Sin number 5. Wherefore does not mean where, it means why. This is a mistake a lot of people make. And you know why they make it? Because when they were kids, they watched stupid cartoons like this one that constantly got it wrong.
Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou?
Wherefore art thou?
Wherefore art thou, Romeo?
It's not even a very good joke. It's just frustrating. Okay, got that grammar Nazi rant off my chest. Back to the movie. Romeo and Juliet decide their 5-minute relationship is enough to build a marriage on, so Romeo goes to contract the services of Friar Lawrence. The friar is an otter and is some kind of neo-pagan voodoo Catholic hybrid, I think? Hey, what do I know about aquatic mammal religion? Maybe that's really how they worship. Being the closest thing this movie has to a responsible adult, Friar Lawrence is a bit put out by Romeo's whirlwind romance.
You jest.
Okay, you're stupid then. However, Friar Lawrence's magical crockpot shows him a vision of the Montagues and Capulets getting along as a result of all this, so he agrees to the marriage, even after seeing how nauseatingly cutesy Romeo and Juliet are together. So Romeo and Juliet get married, and they honeymoon on the Titanic. No, really, they go to this wrecked cruise ship that's obviously a Titanic ripoff and dance among the ruins of the tragedy. Oh well, at least there's no rapping dogs. But alas and alack, Romeo and Juliet discover that seal miscegenation is frowned upon by just about every living species.
A Montague and a Capulet together!
It's disgusting.
Scandalous! I can't stand it!
It's an outrage!
I think I'm gonna be sick.
I'm mortified.
It's horrible!
I can't believe my eyes.
Must be the southern part of the North Atlantic. The lone voice in support of the young couple comes from a young kissing fish creatively named Kissy, the cute animal sidekick, and sin number 6. You thought Mercutio was bad? You ain't seen nothing yet. Kissy was voiced by Phil Nibbling's daughter Chanel, who I'm guessing was about 5 years old at the time. Her dialogue seemed mostly comprised of whatever randomness happened to be floating through her head at the time.
You guys married? Are you having any babies?
Oh,
babies. And I'm like, stinky babies. P.U. Could I be your baby? I mean, your stinky baby.
Look, Phil, I understand. She's your daughter, and this sort of thing is probably really cute if you know the kid and love her. But in a fictional character, it's not that entertaining. It's like the movie comes with its own sugar-addicted ADD preschooler that talks through the whole thing. And we already have one character who will not keep quiet. We don't need another. Speaking of Mercutio, his Stromthurmond comedy hour is interrupted by Prince, who is looking for information on Romeo's whereabouts. Mercutio temporarily suspends his insensitive jokes at the Capulet's expense to do some insensitive jokes at Prince's expense.
This is really gonna hurt.
Yo, blubber butt! I wonder how deep the ocean is when you're not in it! Ah!
Mocking fat people. Fun for the whole family. Romeo intervenes, but fortunately is too late to prevent Prince from chucking Mercutio off a cliff.
Look for me tomorrow, and you will find me a grave seal.
Yes, I know they wouldn't really kill him. Just let me pretend for a little while, all right? It's such a beautiful moment, especially since Mercutio lets go of his own accord and has only himself to blame for it. Romeo attacks Prince in a blind but rather ineffective fury, which somehow causes the cliff to collapse, and Prince banishes Romeo to Shark Island because, well, because he can, I guess. So poor Romeo is in exile a whole 100 yards away from the mainland. To make matters worse, he has Kissy for company.
You wanna hear my little song? Okay, here's my little song. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are.
You know, that may be the best song in the entire movie. And Juliet can't join him and has to stay behind to marry Prince because, look, she just does, okay? So she goes to Friar Lawrence for advice, and at first the good friar is so upset he doesn't know what to say.
Oh, I don't know what to say to this. I don't know what to say. I don't know what to say to this.
Then he got an idea. A crazy idea. The friar got a crazy, convoluted idea.
I'll add a bit of this, and I'll add a bit of that. Spice it up, yes, with an old dead bat. Drink this potion before you wed. You go to sleep, but they think you're dead.
Now that's just sad. The kindly priest character has a better villain song than the actual villain. Friar Lawrence shares the news of Juliet's supposed demise with the Capulets, but unfortunately for him, Benvolio overhears the whole thing and goes to tell Romeo. Realizing there may be one or two flaws in his overly complicated plan, the friar sets off in pursuit but is waylaid by the Shark Island shark.
Why does it always have to be a shark?
So Benvolio reaches the disturbingly chipper Romeo first and tells him the bad news, which causes the world to go monochrome for a moment. Romeo sets off for the mainland in time for Friar Lawrence to just miss him, requiring him to find a way past the shark again.
Come on, Sharky, you big ugly whale. Don't you want to bite my nice furry tail? You like it, you want it, it tastes real fine. You gotta come now, 'cause it's dinner time.
Ugh, I feel even more unclean than usual after watching that. The shark chases the friar all around the not Titanic until he is rescued by...
Come with me if you want to live.
Oh, not that again. And to make matters worse, it has siblings.
It's spanky time! Spanking.
You know, it's times like this that I wish I was better at dealing with the real sinners. The souls of the damned may be whiny and creepy, but they can't be worse than this. After Romeo mourns his loss by calling out Juliet's name for about half a minute, he crashes her funeral and kisses her numb lips, which somehow causes him to get dosed with the zombie potion and pass out apparently dead as well. Seriously? I thought this movie was getting off easy, but there you have it. Sin number 7, using Twinkle Twinkle Little Star as a dirge. It makes you wonder what songs they rejected for this scene. If you're happy and you know it, clap your hands. Having been saved by the creepy fish, Friar Lawrence returns in time to deliver the Aesop.
Montague? See how your hate has found a way to kill your children?
Well, hate, hormones, torturous plotting, and bad communication, but mostly hate.
We are all punished.
Yeah, all punished.
All punished? Well, that would explain Mercutio. And speak of the angel, guess who comes along?
Mercutio!
Hey, it's I!
Thou was having a party and you didn't invite moi? Ah, to surfer the slings and arrows of outrageous...
Ooh, this party looks dead.
I think the idea is Mercutio knows they're not dead because he saw Juliet drink the goofy juice earlier, but that's still a pretty tactless way of going about it. Lo and behold, the sun rises and Romeo and Juliet wake up. And, well, that's about it. Feud's over, everybody's happy, even Prince because he gets hooked up with a lady elephant seal, proving once again that fat people should only mate with their own kind and stay away from the rest of society. Romeo and Juliet swim off over the horizon, probably so he can stick his happy dagger in her sheath, and never was there a tale more of woe than this of those who suffered damn Mercutio. I've noticed something. Romeo and Juliet is one of those stories that needs something like Shakespeare's poetry or Leonard Bernstein's music to back it up. Otherwise, it's kind of stupid. Or maybe it's just the fact that Romeo and Juliet sealed with a kiss has so many other problems that it exaggerates the flaws in the source material. The animation is decent, especially considering that it's the work of just one man. But the score is weak, the tone of the story is uneven, and it features not one, but two extremely aggravating characters. Therefore, the Court of Musical Hell orders these punishments. For being so loudly and aggressively unfunny, we condemn Mercutio to serve as a prop in a Carrot Top routine. For not creating appropriate music to suit the mood and characters, we condemn the music staff to have the J.G. Wentworth jingles stuck in their heads while they're making love. And finally, for forcing us to sit through his daughter's Kids Say the Darndest Things-isms, we condemn Phil Nibbling to a cross-country car trip with the Family Circus Kids and Michelle from Full House. So let it be recorded. This session of the Infernal Court in Musical Hell is now adjourned.